The show is strictly for educational purposes. The opinions expressed on the show are personal to the individuals appearing in the show and not those of Thinking Tree Ecoholics Private Limited. The show is not intended to offend or defame any individual, entity, caste, community, race or religion, or to denigrate any institution, person, living or dead. Listener discretion is strongly advised.
So, hello and welcome to the Thinking Tree series. Today we have with us guest Urvashi Prasad, ma'am, and she is currently working in Niti Aayog as a public policy specialist. So today we will discuss about the impact of coronavirus, especially with the fragile healthcare system of India. So welcome, ma'am. Thank you so much on our show. The first question, ma'am, that I would like to ask on behalf of the students, and we have a lot of students from economics community, and they are studying, preparing for the various examinations, such as the prestigious UPSC examinations. So first of all, I would like to ask you that given the fragile healthcare infrastructure in India, what preemptive measures were taken by Niti Aayog after or before the virus erupted in India?
There have been various health system reforms that have been initiated over the last few years, and various new programs have also been introduced. Now, of course, health, as you know, in India is primarily a state subject. So the center, provides broad sort of guidelines, inputs, frameworks, and it also has certain centrally sponsored schemes and programs. But beyond that, a lot of the actual implementation happens at the state level. So on the health system side, over the last few years, the Ayushman Bharat program has been launched. And that has, of course, two components. One is the health insurance part, which a lot of, lot of you would know about. But there is also the primary care part, which is the health and wellness centers. And that is really more of the direction we need to take in the future, is to focus more on public health and primary care rather than just on the curative care and the insurance, based models, etc. So I think that has been, of course, one big program that the center has launched. Various reforms have been undertaken on medical education, because we know that for a long time we've had a lot of problems with the Medical Council of India. So a lot of reforms have been taken. The National Medical Commission bill has been enacted, and the whole idea is to improve the regulation of medical education in the country, both for modern medicine as well as for our Ayush and traditional medicine systems. Yes. So that has happened on nutrition. We've seen the launch of Poshan Abhiyan, because again, nutrition is a critical determinant of health. So I think there's been various steps that the center has been taking, which some of them, you see the impact in the shorter term, some of them you'll see impact in the longer term. But the whole idea has been to, sort of reform the health system and use different levers to do that. Now, of course, it's always a slow and a gradual process, and it's very difficult to anticipate a pandemic like this. Yes. So I think that is something that, of course, has been difficult world over. We have seen some of the best health systems in the world find it very difficult to cope with this. Yes. So this is, of course, a challenge. But I think we have to persist with these reforms from the center's side and work with states very closely, because, as I said, states play a very important role in the health sector, not only in terms of funding, but in terms of what actually happens on the ground. So I think that we'll have to do, and carry these forward and probably accelerate these now that we have been faced with such a big health crisis, perhaps accelerate these going forward.
Okay, that's great, ma'am. Because states have their own responsibility to implementation. So that's perfectly, like Niti Aayog is working in that direction. We can only advise. Apart from this, like, ma'am, social distancing has been strongly advised to counter the virus, like coronavirus, which is very deadly. Yet we can say the basic structure of slums in India goes against this concept. People living in crowded and unsanitary places. So how do you think this situation can be addressed, especially in the short term and later in the long run?
Yeah, so I think, the concept of social distancing, or rather better to put it as physical distancing, I think that puts it much, in sort of a much clearer way, because, you're required to maintain certain physical distance between people at this time. So I think that sort of puts it more clearly. Now, obviously, that is a challenge. That is a challenge in many of our, our urban centers, dense urban centers, slums. That's also why we are perhaps, facing a lot of issues with, hotspots being urban slum areas, whether it's Dharavi, Mumbai, or, other such, informal settlements, slum areas in different cities. So definitely, where you have people living in very, small spaces, that concept is difficult, to actually achieve all the time. But I think the whole idea of putting this out was that as much as possible, we try and adhere to these norms in public places especially. So, even if in your home, you're not necessarily always able to follow this distancing norm, at least when you are in a public place, at least when you are, outside, you have to try and maintain this. So I think it's more, of course, we realize that all such norms will never be 100% followed in a country like India. They can't be. We have a lot of challenges. We have a lot of poverty still. Even if you look at something like hand washing, right? Now, not in every part of the country do you even have running water in toilets all the time. Or many might not even have soap in toilets all the time. So, of course, we realize that in a country like India, these things are, they're not going to be adhered to 100%. But I would say that we have still seen a lot of adherence. If you compare to the pre-lockdown period to now, when I just go out on the roads, I go to my office, and I have been going from the beginning of the lockdown to, now. And when I compare, there's a huge difference. There's a huge difference in terms of people wearing face, hand hygiene, people being conscious about physical distancing. So I think rather than sort of seeing it as a 0-1 goal over here, we have to see that at least we have come a long way forward from where we were. And I think that is what we need to take into account. And it's much more of an intangible benefit. This benefit is very hard to quantify. So it's a behavioral change. It's a behavioral shift. But given that this pandemic and this disease is going to stay with us for a long time, this is a very important one that people now at least have it in their mind that, to the extent I can, I should try and follow these norms. And of course, the extent to which it can be followed will differ. If you have a house all to yourself, of course, you can follow it much better. If you are living in a crowded, settlement, you can't follow it as well. But to whatever extent you can follow it, there will be some health benefits that will accrue, in the ultimate analysis. Mm-hmm. So I think that's how we have to look at this.
Okay. That's great, ma'am. Like, we have seen a lot of examples before lockdown and after lockdown. So people are like changing their mentality, and what lockdown has done is like created awareness to have social distancing, physical distancing, what you said. So far, ma'am, the Kerala model has been like considered as one of the finest one in India. Kerala has been able to flatten the curve. So also, since we can say it successfully dealt with Nipah virus 2 years ago. So are there any intervention from, we can say, the Kerala model, what are executed in other states around the India or at the national level?
Yeah, I think, one thing that we must all appreciate that the Kerala model is not a new model. Mm. And the Kerala model is not built in one day, one week, 1 month, 2 months. The Kerala model has been built over years. They have consistently for years invested in their health system. They have prioritized public health. They have trained their personnel. They have built infrastructure. They have learned from every, epidemic, whether it is Nipah virus, whether it is, any other. In fact, in Kerala, we had a lot of flooding, just last year, but we didn't see any major infectious disease breakouts, So they handled those situations very well also. So I think we have to appreciate that this model is not a new model. It's a model which has come over years. And if other states want to reach that level, they will have to consistently invest in health. This cannot be a 1 month, 2 month, okay, we have a pandemic right now, so, let's suddenly invest in health and then we all forget about it. It cannot be like that. Healthcare has to be a consistent, everyday investment if you really want to reach those levels. So I think that is something that, first of all, everyone must understand. And just because we are in a pandemic and everyone is talking about health now, It can't be a priority for the short term. It has to be a long term and a consistent priority. Only then are you going to achieve, you know, what you call the Kerala model. Right. So I think at this time, of course, yes, there are learnings from Kerala. They have done their contact tracing very well. They have, followed very good, you know, basic public health steps. I think there are some very basic steps that you need to follow in an epidemic, and they have followed those very well. But as I said, they have the underlying infrastructure. They have the underlying human resource base to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, otherwise, even the very simple steps can be very difficult to execute in practice. So I think, yes, there is learning from Kerala. There's also learning from a lot of other districts and a lot of other states. So even in Maharashtra, if you look at Kasaragod, you know, Kasaragod has done a very good job. They have done intensive contact tracing. They in fact, use the policing system very well. They used a whole host of measures. And in Kasaragod, you had, you know, large number of cases, and they just brought it down to zero, you know, within a matter of weeks. So I think there is learning to be had from various states, from various districts at this point. And states and districts will have to ultimately contextualize what's best for them and what suits them the best. But I think at a higher level, it is important to realize that everyone has to invest in health if you want to then be pandemic ready, you know, if we can put it that way. You can only be pandemic ready, or you can only be crisis ready, if you have been investing in the sector consistently.
Yes.
And there is no magic bullet solution. You cannot just pick up the Kerala model and replicate it somewhere else. There's no magic bullet answers. It is something that requires hard work and consistent investment over a period of time.
Yeah, indeed, because it's not an overnight success. Like, they have also good infrastructure and education as well. So that is correlates with the health one. Yeah, that's great point, ma'am. Like, I was reading, ma'am, one report. I was reading, like, Finch Solution Country Risk Industry Research. And according to that report, more than 80% of the population still does not have any significant health insurance coverage. Approximately 68% of Indians have limited or no access to essential medicine. Furthermore, if you see, like, over the last two decades, the availability of free medicines in the public healthcare facilities has declined from 31% to around 8.9%. And that's a recent data, like in May 2020, they have released. And that is after the advent of Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, that is Ayushman Bharat. So how do you think we can rectify this situation? We can, like, increase the reach of our public healthcare system?
Yeah, so I think on the insurance side, that is why Ayushman Bharat, you know, the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana was brought in. And of course, it's still a relatively new scheme. It was introduced only in September 2018. But in just under 2 years of its launch, it's already treated, you know, already 1 crore patients have availed of treatment under this scheme. So that's a fairly large number, given that for some months the scheme was, you know, just ramping up and sort of expanding its access. So I think that's a good number. And I think hopefully through that scheme, as the coverage ramps up, we'll be able to cover at least India's most vulnerable and poorest families, because that's really the idea, that we start first with India's most vulnerable and poorest. And then we move up. I think there is no denying that we cannot stop at this level, you know, because there is also a large segment of people in the middle class who you can call the missing middle. So it's sort of the middle, because you have the bottom of the pyramid, you have the poorest, which Ayushman Bharat is now trying to, you know, cover and take care of. Then you have the rich, you know, who can afford their own insurance. They can get private health insurance. That's not the issue. But you have a large chunk of people in the middle, including, you know, the lower middle class and, you know, other people who might not have any sort of other type of option. So ultimately, I think PMJ, you know, can be expanded to this missing middle also. So I think that is something that will happen in stages. I think that's something the government also understands. So that is something, that is a direction we should see the country taking. But the other part is on the public healthcare, and that is where I feel that the health and wellness centers are very important, which is the second pillar of Ayushman Bharat. And we don't talk about it enough. We talk more about PMJ. But we must talk about health and wellness centers also, because, you know, these centers have very good potential to provide this sort of first level of primary care treatment that people need. And now, because of the pandemic, we've also seen a boost, you know, to telemedicine. So if we can integrate telemedicine with these health and wellness centers, then we can actually ensure that people in our most rural and remote areas who otherwise do not have medical advice can get access. You know, even if you cannot have physical consultations with doctors or doctors are not present in those areas, you can use telemedicine at these health and wellness centers and still get, you know, good quality advice out to people. So I think we must really invest in our health and wellness centers. Again, how they run on the ground, how they are operationalized, states have a big role to play in this. The center has provided a template. The center is providing, you know, certain amount of funding. But I think the states need to also, you know, focus a lot on the health and wellness centers. Because without ramping up our public health and our primary care, we are not going to get good outcomes in health. You know, health can never be a cure-focused system. If you look at the United States, they spend about 17% of their GDP on health. It's the highest number in the world. But look at their condition today. You know, they are really struggling with this pandemic because United States is a very hospital and a very insurance-focused health. They don't invest enough in public health. They don't invest enough in primary care and prevention. So we must ensure that we don't go down that way. We have to focus more on the public health side, on the preventive side. Otherwise, you know, any amount of money you spend on health will not seem enough, especially when we have such a large population. So I think that those are the two sort of pillars that we really need to focus on. Of course, we need to ramp up the insurance coverage. There's no doubt about it. We need to equally focus on these health and wellness centers and on our public health interventions.
Yes. Since, ma'am, like you were the part of WHO as well, like I was reading somewhere, WHO's chief scientist, Dr. Swaminathan, has expressed the concern and warned that rural India may become a next coronavirus hotbed, and emphasize the need to use this opportunity to strengthen and improve the public healthcare system, especially in the rural areas. Like we have seen in the example of Jatkhedi, where a bride infected 35 guests at her wedding. So what are the solutions that, in your mind, like to address the problems in the rural area?
Yeah, I mean, see, thankfully, till now, the disease has been largely concentrated and still remains largely concentrated in our urban centers, and that too, a handful of our urban centers. I was looking at the numbers just last night, and even till last night, you know, around 63% of our total cases have been concentrated in just top 10 cities across India. Yes. So this is a reasonably manageable sort of situation. And of course, the lockdown has also played a big role in ensuring this, because imagine if the whole country was, you know, left completely open, by now the disease would have definitely reached all parts of the country. So I think right now we are not in a very sort of difficult situation. But yes, now as we have gradually opened up, we are having a lot of movement of migrants back to their states, back to their villages. And that's why you're also seeing certain states are now spiking, which have been stable for a long time. You know, whether it's a Bihar or, you know, whether it's a Karnataka, you are seeing certain spikes in certain states. So I think we have to still focus very strongly on containing the spread of the disease, because frankly, if it reaches, you know, all our rural areas and reaches our remotest parts, we are in big trouble. You know, we will not be able to handle something. I don't think any country in the world can handle it. So even we will not be able to. So we have to still focus very much on ensuring that the disease is still contained. And I think the contact tracing, the quarantining of people when they are coming from one state to another, whether it's a home quarantine or whether it's an institutional quarantine, we'll have to, you know, follow all these norms very, very strictly. Because if we completely open up everything and we just allow complete free movement of people, then we could be in trouble. There is no doubt on that. I think it has to be very calibrated. You know, yes, we are opening up. We need to open up for economic reasons. We don't want to cause hardships to, you know, our poor people. So yes, opening up of the lockdown has been important, and it's been done also. Now, if you see, the center has largely decentralized decision making with respect to the lockdown. down to states. But I would say that we have to be very cautious still. You know, we cannot just let it go out of our hands. And because, you know, if it reaches our poorest tribal areas and, you know, other such parts of the country, then we are genuinely in big trouble. You know, then I think it is going to be very, very difficult. Yeah. So we have to still try and ensure that it remains concentrated to these, you know, relatively few centers. And we don't really allow it to spread too much beyond that. So I think that is the main challenge at hand right now.
It means right now we can just stop spreading towards rural areas because the prevention is very, very difficult, especially in the tribal areas like we have seen in the news in Andaman as well. So, yeah. So like right now, as you were talking about the opening up, gradual opening up of the economy as well as like other sectors of the economy, especially those are essentials. Like recently, I was reading in newspaper that France has opened up its school and had to shut down again due to the 70 new cases of coronavirus in the students, COVID. And the school, what do you think, like, are we prepared for conducting the 12th board examination without risking the health of the students or teachers or the staff involved in it?
Yeah, see, that's exactly what I was referring to, that, you know, that is why it has to be in a very calibrated way. It cannot be, you know, because otherwise you'll have to keep doing these flip-flops. And I think these flip-flops are actually worse. Because, you know, it gives a lot of creates a lot of uncertainty. And then it's very difficult, you know, whether it's a business or whether it's anybody else. You know, if you're a migrant worker, I mean, you're not going to come back to the city because you'll keep wondering that, you know, when a lockdown happen again, and then again, you'll be stuck. So I think the flip-flops is what is more worrying. And this is what states need to be very careful, because now the decision making has been decentralized to a great extent to the level of the states. The center is providing still broad guidelines and frameworks. But I think, you know, just given the natural course of the pandemic, and also based on the prime minister, he had several interactions with all the chief ministers. It has been decentralized, you know, it has been, you know, I think that's something the states also wanted, that, you know, we should be more in charge of decisions regarding lockdown. So that has been done, but we have to be very cautious. That is why I keep saying that, because otherwise we'll see that, you know, we'll open up and then again we'll have to lock down, because if we see a sudden unmanageable spike, then we might be left with no other choice. So I think we have to really, therefore, do it in a gradual and calibrated manner. We cannot just suddenly say that, okay, now we are all open and everything is fine and, you know, everything is completely back to normal. If we do that, then it's very risky. So I think any opening up in any state should be gradual. You know, of course, the essential services, of course, the, you know, economic activity should, we should try to resume that to the extent possible. But we should not, you know, go to an extreme position. Because that is equally risky. And then, you know, the last thing we want is again having to lock down everything, because that will just create so much uncertainty for everyone. So I think we have to be careful. But I would say that, yes, this is a very, you know, this is not something that people are used to. This pandemic is not something that anybody in their living memory has, you know, sort of really dealt with. So, you know, it's also difficult to judge any country or any state on you know, that, you know, why did they open up and now they've locked down? Because I think it's very difficult to anticipate. It's genuinely very difficult what, you know, shape and what course this pandemic is going to take. So I don't think I would, you know, judge any country or any state's decision as right or wrong. But I would just say that a cautious, graded, you know, calibrated approach is our best bet. Beyond that, you know, we don't know. This virus is a new virus. We are learning things about it every day. So it's very hard to, you know, sort of say what is exactly the right thing to do or not. But I think being a sort of cautious, having a calibrated approach is therefore our best bet.
Because if the lockdown will open on and we have to put again the lockdowns, it would be very difficult for the administration to deal with, and also for the people. So it's very like, government and the people should approach the cautious approach so that they follow the norms, rules and regulation. Ma'am, another question is, like, one key issue is the trust deficit in the public health system in many parts of the country. And there have been like repeated news reports of the people are like escaping hospital or quarantine, or in the past week, we can say. How can this impact the ongoing control of the COVID-19, and what government can do to protect this? Because people are hiding their, if they are infected, they are hiding the news from the authorities. So what is your take on?
Yeah, I think, you know, the first thing that we need to really address collectively is the stigma. The reason people are hiding is because of social stigma. And I think here we all have a role to play. You know, we have heard of some resident welfare associations really overstepping their brief and, you know, saying that if you're a health professional, you can't come back and live here, you know, or putting in place all sorts of rules that they have no authority to, you know. So RWA is, you know, they're not above the law of the land. You know, they still have to follow the law of the land. But we have seen that in some places, you know, a little bit of overzealousness has come in. But it has also brought in discrimination. And we have to be very careful not to do that, because the moment you start discriminating against a health worker or discriminating against a patient or his or her family, people will hide it. People will hide it. People will start misclassifying the disease, you know, because nobody will want to show that my family member died due to COVID, you know. So we will then run into a lot of problems if we keep stigmatizing it. And I think that is a role that each one of us as citizens, you know, has to play. Is to say that we will not spread misinformation, we will not get carried away by headlines, you know, just because, you know, somebody is saying, oh, there's been a death here, there's been a death there. I mean, we should not forget that there are other diseases which take many more lives on a daily basis. Now, right now, because we are in a pandemic, everybody's talking about COVID, so it's natural. But we should not, you know, take it to levels where people feel that, oh my God, this is a death sentence. You know, if I get COVID, then I cannot survive, because that is not true. If you see, fortunately, in India, the disease is large. And in fact, you have 70-80% of patients being completely asymptomatic. So I think, you know, we have to send the right messaging out that the elderly have to be careful. People with underlying conditions need to be careful. If you have diabetes, you have a heart condition, you have a kidney issue, of course, you need to be extra careful. But it's not a death sentence. And so we need to stop stigmatizing and we need to stop creating this fear, because then people will hide, people will run away, and then we will be faced with a bigger problem, you know, because then it is very difficult to contain the disease if people are not even revealing their true status or people are not willing to get tested. So I think that is something that we collectively as a society, you know, along with civil society organizations, along with, you know, citizen groups, volunteer groups, and of course the government, we need to put an end to this stigma, because we see a stigma in a lot of diseases, and it really hampers our progress, whether it's tuberculosis, whether it is HIV, AIDS, you know, unfortunately, all these diseases get stigmatized. So we need to break that stigma very, very consciously. But on the other part about the quarantine centers and all of that, yes, you know, state governments have to ensure good quality. You know, we have to ensure that people are not uncomfortable in these centers, you know, like we've seen in some places, they have set up very good quarantine centers, very clean facilities, very hygienic facilities. So I think, again, you know, this is something which is an administration issue, and it needs to be managed well. Of course, people, you know, should not feel like they are locked up in these places, or, you know, they don't have food, or they don't have, you know, clean toilet facilities, because then people will run away. So I think we have to ensure that. But we have also now given the option of home quarantine. I think that's sort of the last point on this, that if you can afford to and you can be in touch with the health system and you can follow the protocols, then you can actually be at home also. Now, quarantine is not necessary in an institutional facility. You can also be at home if you can afford that. So I think, you know, we are bringing in new guidelines. You know, we are evolving it constantly based on the feedback we are getting, based on the situation on the ground. But I think it will need I think the biggest issue in this is to break the stigma. And I think that will need all of us to work together.
Yes. That's indeed, ma'am. Like, if we see, like, what is the way forward right now? We are in the last week of May, like, and what do you think, what is the need of the hour? Like, we can be able to control this disease without the need of medicine, or what do you predict, like, when medicine will come? So what is the way forward, what you can think?
I mean, you know, it will take some time, I think, before we have a vaccine or a cure as such, or a proper treatment. And in fact, vaccine is not a given. I think that is something that people also need to understand, that there are many diseases for which we still don't have a vaccine, you know. So we can't assume that a vaccine will come. I mean, I certainly hope it does. And given that the whole world is investing in this right now, I certainly hope that we will get a vaccine, or we will get a good cure, a good treatment which can be scaled up. But that might still take a while because, you know, we have to go through all the trials and, you know, we have to go through that. So I think till then we have to, our best bet is really twofold. One is we have to follow these norms of physical distancing, of hand hygiene, of covering your, you know, nose and mouth whenever you're outside. And you don't have to use a surgical mask. I think the Prime Minister has made this clear many times that you can use a simple, clean, you know, cloth, a handkerchief, whatever you might have. But you must cover your, you know, face when you're outside. That is really, really important because that will help to break the sort of transmission and spread of this infection. So I think we have to be careful. We have to change our personal hygiene and public hygiene behaviors. And I think that is something that should stay with us even beyond this pandemic. You know, I think I find it interesting that for a lot of us, it seems that we have just discovered hand washing. And that should not be the case. You know, hand washing is always a good thing. Hand washing will always protect you from various diseases. So I really hope that some of these, you know, hygiene behaviors will stay with us, you know, regardless of what happens to this pandemic. But I think the other thing for us will be also boost our immunity. And I think that is another important thing, that we have to focus on our nutrition. We have to, you know, follow a sort of healthy, regular lifestyle, diet, exercise. Because sometimes, you know, this is such a stressful time. We are also seeing a lot of mental health issues happening at this time. So we have to focus on, you know, maintaining as normal a lifestyle as we can. Focus on our diet. Focus on having a daily routine. Because that will also, you know, give us the strength to fight this. I think ultimately we have to understand that if your immune system is strong and you don't have any underlying conditions, you should be able to fight this perfectly well. In fact, you might not have any symptoms at all. Or if you have, then those symptoms might be very mild. So it's nothing to be afraid of, but we do have to take precautions and we do have to boost our immunity in whatever way we can with, you know, whatever resources that we have at our disposal. That is something that we do need to focus on.
So it means just like protection, what we can do is the best cure right now. And ma'am, like final words about the alcoholics, where for the students, what will be your golden words for their guidance?
I think this is a great initiative and it's wonderful that, you know, you are taking up these very topical issues and discussing them in detail. I think you must continue these conversations because, as I said, that every segment of society has a role to play in this. You know, it's not just government which is going to, you know, handle this whole thing. So, you know, whether it's discussions like these, students then, you know, going out and spreading these right messages in their families, in their communities, I think we need everybody to, you know, sort of chip in at this time. So I think it's a very good platform that you have, that you're discussing these very topical issues, and I hope you continue to do that and, you know, bring in different people to talk about different facets of it. Because I think in this, what is interesting is that the public health side is very closely linked with the economics. And for the first time, I think we are seeing that, you know, you can't really separate out the, you know, the public health side from your economic side. So it'll be good to have more of these integrated sort of discussions so that people can get a more holistic perspective.
Thank you so much, ma'am, because I started Thinking Tree and our team is working hard really behind this. We have a team of around 20 people, so they're working well and in research. Just from the platform Thinking Tree, I would like to tell you that we just working on the result-oriented aspects, like solution, especially in the research. So that's the message. And thank you so much, ma'am. It's a pleasure being here on the platform Ecoholics.
Thank you.
And
thank you for inviting.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your time. It's a wonderful experience with you discussing the healthcare. And we'll hope that we'll meet soon in the future with another topic, another discussion. And all the best, ma'am, for the working towards the healthcare infrastructure. We need more people, more dedicated people like you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.